While the great deal of the attention of the country, of the world, of the media is what's going on right now in Ukraine, let's not forget that other conflicts are still ongoing. And the United States, which in many of these cases, Yemen in particular, has not had a great impact on that conflict so far, still could change its approach, could change its stance. And there is a chance in the near future that something like that might happen. Joining us now to discuss is the legislative director for Middle East policy at the Friends Committee for National Legislation, Hassan El-Tayyab. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks so much for having me, John.
It's great to have you here. We're once again talking about Yemen, once again identifying a possible opening for something to be done. Specifically, last month, two members of the House had introduced a new War Powers Resolution in relation to the situation in Yemen. How is that going? Do we expect there to be movement on that? What are your expectations as of right now?
Well, I really appreciate you bringing me on to discuss Yemen, as you know, so many of my colleagues in Congress and the administration is really concerned about Ukraine. Obviously, a huge issue going on over there, and we are opposed to authoritarianism and imperialism wherever it exists. And this situation in Yemen is something that we, as United States citizens, are complicit in through our ongoing military participation. The Biden administration started off, you know, promising to end US support for the war, but it's been anything but. We've greenlighted over $1 billion of new weapon sales to Saudi Arabia, and we've continued to provide spare parts, maintenance, and logistical support for Saudi warplanes engaged in these offensive operations. In January, we actually saw Saudi Arabia just increase its onslaught of Yemen. They targeted a reservoir cutting off water to 120,000 people, hit a detention facility, killing 90, wounding 200 more. And the escalation even since then has continued. So in response to all that violence, Rep. Jayapal and Rep. Peter DeFazio in the House have promised in an op-ed in The Nation that they are going to pursue a new Yemen War Powers Resolution and try to get that introduced by the 7th anniversary of the war in March of this year. So in just a few weeks' time, we're expecting to see this resolution introduced. And what's really unique about the War Powers Resolution is it ensures a floor vote and floor consideration. So thank you again for bringing me on to discuss this news.
Yeah, obviously anytime. I mean, we've spoken a couple times during what so far we've had of the first term for Joe Biden. He had on the campaign trail, and I believe in some statements after inauguration, implied that there would be a changing of the approach of the United States to this conflict. And there have been occasional headlines implying that we are withdrawing from certain types of sharing of intelligence, those sorts of things. But based on what you're laying out, how different is the US involvement under Biden versus under Trump as the war continues? Is it that significant of a change?
Well, appearing to have changed US policy, the Biden administration really did a public relations stunt. They came on air, Biden went to the State Department February 4 of last year, said we're gonna end support for offensive operations, but never actually defined what offensive and defensive meant. Members of Congress asked a bunch of clarifying questions and didn't get a response. We had over 100 lawmakers last year say Saudi must end its blockade. We even had a majority in the House vote on the National Defense Authorization Act to end all US participation. But the Biden administration wasn't clear about what they constituted as offensive or defensive support, but did proceed to let us know that logistical support, spare parts and maintenance, which are all essential to these Saudi warplanes, provided the assistance needed for the Saudi warplanes to do these airstrikes in January that killed 90 civilians and cut off water to 120,000 people. That's all still being provided by the United States. And what this War Powers Resolution, what they intend to do with it is to finally cut off these ongoing spare parts and maintenance contracts that are keeping these warplanes in the air and keeping this war going.
Yeah. Well, look, as we were talking about before we went live with this interview, we're in a time right now where there is a still relatively new war going on in Ukraine right now. People are very focused on this. The world is focused on the negative impact of one country destroying another, effectively. The threat to civilians, the damage that's being done. So that, in theory, presents an opening. Do you think that the fact that that's such a big backdrop to the news right now, that it's going to be a big focus of the State of the Union, means that perhaps Congress will be more ready to assert, like to sort of throw around their weight in this? Like the War Powers Act is that's older than us at this point, very rarely invoked. Do we think that what's going on in Ukraine makes it more or less likely that the move that you were sketching out earlier is to happen?
Well, it kind of cuts both ways, John. There is part of it that, you know, is a lot of the oxygen is getting sucked out of the room because of the situation in Ukraine, and it's diverting a lot of people's attention from other issues like the war in Yemen, like the hunger crisis in Afghanistan, escalating violence, in Palestine. But the other, you know, the glass half full angle is that members of Congress, you know, have an opportunity here to take action. This is something unlike the situation in Ukraine. We don't have a lot of leverage to end the Russian onslaught. I think, you know, the Biden administration should prioritize protecting civilians, refugee resettlement. They should prioritize diplomacy. But, you know, obviously Ukraine's a terrible situation, but the Saudi-led war in Yemen and blockade that's pushed 16 million people to the brink of famine, 400,000 children suffering from severe acute malnutrition. This is something we have maximum leverage over with the Saudis. We can compel them to end their blockade, to end these airstrikes, because if they don't, we can cut off this supply of spare parts and maintenance and this logistical support, and also cut them off from future weapon sales. So, you know, as opposed to the situation in Ukraine, which is devastating, we oppose authoritarianism and imperialism wherever it exists. The situation in Yemen, is something we can do something about right now. And I'll also flag the hypocrisy on many levels. I mean, we have Linda Thomas Greenfield at the UN saying that Russia needs to obey international law. Completely agree with that. But that does not resonate to a lot of people that are looking at the United States as it pursued, this war in Yemen with really no international law being respected. You've got the UAE annexing parts of Yemen. You've got the war in Iraq as well, which, you know, on really shaky legal grounds when you look at the, you know, international law. So the US, really, this is a wake up call. The US has to get its own house in order. If we want to pursue, international law and support diplomacy, we have to get our own house in order here. And the war in Yemen is number one priority for FCNL and so many grassroots advocates across the country, because, you know, that's how we, you know, get a rules-based international order.
Exactly. Yeah. And obviously, like, the comparison between the two is imperfect in that one conflict has been going on for a number of years. One is still relatively new. There are some things like that. But when you lay it out the way that you just did, like imagine if the US was providing spare parts to Russia right now. That's effectively the relationship that we have. People wouldn't accept it. So why are they? Does it bother you at all that, like you referenced that airstrike that killed 90 people? I pay attention to the news. I pay attention to international news. I pay attention to news about this conflict. I mean, we've talked about it. I can't even tell you how many times. I didn't even know about that strike. And yet I can tell you many things about what's going on in Ukraine right now. Earlier on the show, we had video. CNN was on the ground showing destroyed vehicles, and they profiled this grandma who's making Molotov cocktails, like helping give people blankets and everything. And I said on the show, I have a feeling their grandma's doing that in Yemen right now, and yet they're not being profiled on CNN. They're human, I've checked. Does it bother you that there's such a different approach, not just by the media, but by regular people? Like SNL had the Ukrainian choir on, which is good, I'm glad that they did that. But I don't think that they had a Yemeni choir on, you know, back when this war was new. Does that bother you?
Well, short answer is yes. I mean, we're dealing with a situation where Mohammed bin Salman, is the Putin of the Middle East. He is an aggressor. He is going into Yemen, a sovereign country, doing airstrikes on civilians. And we have a lot of leverage over this situation, and we can do something about it. I think, if anything, the coverage of Ukraine has taught maybe the American people what we how we should be covering war. It's a very serious issue. It's hurting a lot of civilians, and we need to apply that same sort of attention to detail and focus on the humanitarian suffering, to other conflicts, like Afghanistan, like the war in Syria, like the war in Yemen, the war in Ethiopia. I mean, we have a lot of work to do, and so of course it does bother me, but when we get back to basics by introducing this War Powers Resolution, getting a vote on the House floor, that is a chance for us to get back to the top of the marquee and really, focus people's attention on this really desperate issue. And my heart goes out to people everywhere that are suffering from, violence at the hands of imperialism, whether it's in the Middle East or in Eastern Europe or elsewhere.
Exactly. No, and that is the only sane way to approach it. As you've pointed out, there's an important date coming up. Hopefully our representatives use this opportunity as best they can. And I want to thank you, as always, for your work, you writing op-eds, raising awareness about this, and joining us as well. Thank you, Hassan, for all that you do in making sure that people stay focused on this.
And thank you in this hectic time for you to carve out a space for me to come talk about Yemen. If people do want to take action, there's a simple thing that they can do is they can call 1-833-STOP-WAR. I'll say that again, 1-833-STOP-WAR. Make your voice heard, call your legislator and say it's time to end US support for the Saudi-led war and blockade on Yemen.
Awesome, thank you for that. Hopefully we'll talk again soon.
You got it.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.